Yes, Dominic.
Okay, excellent. Right, thank you, Jean-Pierre. It's now time to start the first session, and our first speaker will be Professor Elanganan Arunan. So let me introduce him in a few sentences. He's currently the chair of the Inorganic and Physical Chemistry Department at the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, in India. His group uses a molecular beam microwave spectrometer to investigate weakly bound complexes. And thanks to detailed investigation on complexes involving water and hydrogen sulfide, his team contributed to unraveling the intricacies of hydrogen bonding. So recently, Professor Arunan chaired a task group under the auspice of UPAC to redefine hydrogen bonding. And his group discovered the carbon bond, which became part of the tetrahedral bond. And his main interest has been to find unifying themes in inter and intramolecular bonding. And this is actually the topic he's going to talk about today. And the title of his talk is A New Classification of Intermolecular Bonding. Please.
Hey, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. I would like to thank Jean-Pierre and the ICNA 2021 team for this opportunity to speak in front of you. The title of my talk is New Classification of Intermolecular Bonding. I need to acknowledge several students and collaborators before I begin. To Pankaj Mandal started all this. All the students who have been listed here have contributed enormously to my understanding of this field. I will focus on the work done by Sharon Priya and Arjit Das in this talk, though it will have contributions from all of them. We have a lot of collaborators, Robert Joss from University of Rennes, Manuel Gobi from Lille, Jettel's project, Nick Walker from Newcastle, and Chris Midcroft and Frank Lowers from NIST. Before I begin, let me give you two quotes, one by Sir William Brock. He says, the important thing in science is not so much to obtain new facts as to discover new ways of thinking about them. I really find it very interesting. And then we have this quote by Polanyi. He says, molecules, however diffuse the new quantum mechanics made them, they were as real and as tangible. And they reward you with, if you put your faith in the reality, they would reward you by giving insights. It so happens, just a couple of years ago, we celebrated the 150 years of periodic table, Journal of Chemical Sciences published by Indian Academy of Sciences and Springer, brought out a special issue. Arijit Das and I wrote an article for this issue where we had compared the bonding in period two dimers, starting from lithium two to neon two. What is quite interesting about this dimers is that they cover the whole spectrum of bonding or interaction, if you would like to call it. We noted that the electron density classifies bonds. You can see N2, O2, F2 in this red, they are all covalent. Lithium, boron, and copper, carbon two are somewhat different. And then beryllium and neon are more like the closed shell interactions. But if you look at the electrostatic potential at the, it won't call it a bond critical point, but the critical point between two nuclei for the electrostatic potential, they give a very unified picture. And of course, those of you are interested, you can read this. And last year turned out to be 100 years of hydrogen bonding. If you take Latimer and Rodebush paper, which was published in 1920 to be the beginning, I edited a volume for Journal of Indian Stuff Science, also published by Springer. I had written an article titled 100 Years After Latimer and Rodebush Paper, Hydrogen Bond Remains an Elephant. Of course, here you have an elephant and six blind men, some thinking of electrostatics, some saying van der Waals radii, linearity, redshift, charge transfer covalency, most electronegative, and so on. One article that I had referred to this in this is given here. This talks about the most important hydrogen bonds, this between adenine and thymine. they point out that there are these two hydrogen bonds which are well known. And then we have the CH4 interaction there in zero group, what it is. So in the title, they say red shifted hydrogen bonds and blue shifted van der Waals contact, the standard. So of course, they have done the atoms in molecules theory, which I'm sure most of you are aware of. According to them, look at the Koch and Papalia criteria. This was a JPC paper in 1995-96. CH2 also qualifies as hydrogen bond in this list. Of course, if you optimize the structure just between adenine and thymine, this would not be a minimum. That's another complication. In 2021, we are now. I'm going to propose a periodic table of intermolecular bonding in this meeting. If you look at this meeting, it's the International Conference of Non-Covalent Interactions, and we are going to be talking about bonding. These interactions and bonding keep coming again and again. This new proposal that we have could be a simpler classification. We note that the similarities between intra and intermolecular bonding, suggesting that this new classification may after all be really old. Here's a brief outline of my talk. For the introduction, chemical bonding, I have put bonding in bold. Two major issues for chemistry, I'll tell them what they are. And of course, if you read papers before 2000, they will always say there are two kinds of intermolecular interaction. One is hydrogen bonding, another is van der Waals interactions. You know, bonding and interactions again come. And as the chair mentioned, we do microspectroscopy in a molecular beam, water dimer versus hydrogen dimer. It really led us to challenge the IUPAC definition. We proposed a carbon bond some years ago after some microspectroscopic work. This has given us a good indication of 3-centered 2-electron bonds. We have really come up with a new classification of that. You mentioned that. Some years ago, we published a paper on hydrogen, chlorine, and lithium bonding. It really highlighted the difference between intermolecular bonding by covalent and ionic molecules. The first ICNI, I spoke about alkaline bond. But this has led us to a new classification that I will describe now. If you look at covalent bond, IUPAC Gold Book, of course, this conference is funded by IUPAC. It says covalent bond, the definition is it says a region of high electron density. It's defining covalent bond, but it says it's a region of high electron density between nuclei, which arises at least from sharing of electrons, gives an attractive force. In this covalent bond, they also give links to four other topics: agnostic, coordination, hydrogen bond, and multicenter bond. They don't mention ionic bond here. And if you click on hydrogen bond, it gives the definition that was from the 1994. IUPAC is yet to update the gold book with the new definition. I returned to them many times and I stopped doing it now. So it still has the old definition. And here it says the hydrogen bond is a form of association. So covalent bond is a region, hydrogen bond is a form of association. But of course, the definition that we published, we say it's an attractive interaction. And of course, here again, they put NO and F. This is what we didn't like. It's been changed, but this is what the IUPAC Gold Book has now. Now, what's really interesting, if you go to the ionic bond, I hope all of you can see. Ionic bond is defined as the bond between two atoms. You know, covalent bond is a region, hydrogen bond is a form of association, but ionic bond is the bond between atoms with sharply different electronegatives. Electrostatic attraction, you know, this is what we say for hydrogen bond as well. Of course, it is covalent bond. Here, there is no accumulation of electron density between the two atoms. Though ionic bond is taught from high school, chemical bond has become synonymous with covalent bond, and this is what has led to a lot of needless confusion, debate, and controversies. If we look at a diatomic molecule, this is the other complication. First thing is the word bond itself and everyone equating chemical bond to covalent bond. Second is the dynamics. Now, if you look at a diatomic molecule, of course, all of us would know it's bonded right here. This is the bonding distance, equilibrium distance. So as long as the distance is here, we know it is bonded. But what if the distance is here, but the energy is way up here? It can have only half a collision and then it bounces back to dissociating molecules. Do we still call it a bond? If it's a harmonic oscillator, it will always be bonded, not for a real molecule. So dynamics is equally important. One is the terminology, another is dynamics. And of course, what about a polyatomic molecule? Polyatomic for a physical chemist may mean is just triatomic molecule. Now, all of us know this water structure. We draw this two OH bond, but we rarely draw a bond between two hydrogen atoms. Maybe laughing, why do we need to worry about it? But we don't do that, isn't it? We know two OH bonds, but there is no bond between two hydrogen atoms. This is not trivial. Now, let me tell you the periodic table from IUPAC. This is factual. There is no color except for the lanthanides and actinides. It lists the groups and periods. And if you go to Royal Society, they have a more colorful periodic table. You see colors everywhere. And you see some where hydrogen has a different color, but other group ones have similar. But if you look beyond hydrogen, all the other elements have the same color everywhere. I like the American Chemical Society periodic table. It is somewhat different. Here, of course, hydrogen has a different color. All the other metals have different colors. All periods have different color. But if you look here, carbon is different. Boron is different in that group. Nitrogen and phosphorus are different. And of course, they try to differentiate metals and non-metals and some other classifications. This looks good. And of course, there are periodic tables for intermolecular bonds. This is from a paper of Alcota and Frantara. They have classified these interactions, kinase bond for the group 11, spodium bond for group 12, trial bond, tetral bond, nitrogen bond, chalcogen bond, halogen bond. These two have been defined by IUPAC, and then noble gas bonds. In fact, a few years ago, Frantara's group published a paper in Anguante Chemie where they had called these noble gas bonds as aerogen bonding. And of course, Krasnati's group published a paper in Accounts of Chemical Resistance in 2019. They have given this periodic table. Of course, they say alkali metal bond, trial bond, tetral bond, nitrogen bond, this is all fine. And they have only a hydrogen bond and they left the other group. And of course, lithium bond was published in 1970 itself. Coleman, Lieben and Allen published this paper. And Josh Pimentel came up with a matrix infrared isolation infrared study on lithium bonding. Of course, these are not very well known, but this did influence me to give a research proposal on lithium bonded complex with microwave spectroscopy. Of course, that was not my research topic during my PhD. I proposed this as a research proposal to be eligible for PhD. I'm glad we could eventually build a microwave spectrometer and look at complexes like this, but we could not look at lithium bond itself. We only published a few computational papers on lithium bonding. I written this statement in my proposal. Hydrogen bonding is as unique in intermolecular interactions as hydrogen is in the periodic table. Now I can say it is true. Now, somewhat interestingly, I reviewed the annual reviews of physical chemistry in 2011. There was a review by Heaven, Merritt, and Bondibay on beryllium clusters. They compare lithium 2, beryllium 2, magnesium 2, and neon 2. They highlight that beryllium is very different. And if we look at the lithium 2, the bond distance is much smaller than the Van der Waals radii. Magnesium 2 bond distance is almost like Van der Waals radii. This is very weakly bound. This is very strongly bound. So this is covalent. This is Van der Waals interaction. In beryllium, we don't know. If you look at hydrogen bonding, that's precisely the reason the name came about. So I had just written this. Chemists do not worry about these clusters. If they did, they would have called it a beryllium bond. But of course, this is published in 2012. And the very next year, Russell Boyd and Coos published a paper on beryllium bond. Of course, now we have lithium bond, beryllium bond, and we have magnesium bonds. Arjit Das had submitted a thesis in 2016 on magnesium and beryllium bonds. We had published a paper on sodium bond, more particularly why it is not commonly observed. I'll tell you why that is the case. If you look at sodium halide dimers and hydrogen fluoride, for example, HF and sodium fluoride dimer, HF dimer is somewhat linear or quasi-linear. Sodium fluoride dimer is either perfectly linear or antiparallel. Basically, you have a linear molecule like this or antiparallel. That's what dipole-dipole interaction is. Hydrogen bond is not dipole-dipole interaction, and this should be obvious even though everybody still calls it dipole-dipole. If you look at all this, often when they're convinced about something not being a hydrogen bond, they say it's a Van der Waals interaction. Van der Waals equation is the origin. Based on this, we have Van der Waals forces, Van der Waals radius, Van der Waals volume, all of them are used. Van der Waals radius when the atoms barely touch one another without interacting or bonding. Van der Waals interaction was the term used until Linus Pauling realized the difference between the solid structure of ice and water and hydrogen sulfide. In water, we have nicely only four neighbors. It's a very loosely packed structure. Ice floats in liquid water. But in hydrogen sulfide, you have 12 neighbors. There's a center one, six around, three on top, three below here. It's almost like a sphere. So we just bought some oranges and took these photographs. So the H2S and H2O solid looks very different like this. Of course, for a physicist, it can all be van der Waals interaction. They like to unify things. Chemists like to classify. So this became hydrogen bonding. This we did not know. This remained van der Waals interaction. You can see throughout the literature, anytime we didn't understand some intermolecular interaction, it was called van der Waals interaction. As and when we understood it, we started giving them name. We can compare human interaction, which is probably easier for us. It was inspired by Chris Arkwright. Here are two men. Of course, these are the premiers of India and France today, smiling at each other, shaking their hand. Maybe there is some attraction, contact, and bonding. Here again, you have two men. They are really knocking each other. There's probably more forceful contact, but clearly there is no bonding. If you come to Bombay or Uttar Pradesh in India, you would see trains packed like this. You know, this is what crystallographers would probably call it packing. There is plenty of contact, but there is probably no bond. And then we have strange situations like this. As best as you could see, there seems to be no contact between these two gentlemen. And on top of this here, you see there is plenty of contact between those two. On the right, you see our Prime Minister and the opposition leader. This is like no contact and bonding. And here there is plenty of contact, probably no bonding. One person says, I want to bond. Another person says, don't come near. Now often humans have faces and there are expressions. You can find out if they like you or hate you. And of course, we do have humans who smile at you, but they have no idea what they are thinking. Molecules don't even have faces. How are we going to figure this out? If you look at what is a hydrogen bond, this is the paper that was published by Latimer and Rodebus. Of course, it was in the literature before this, but Latimer and Rodebus was probably the first to recognize that a hydrogen held between two octets constitutes a weak bond. It was called a union and different names before. They were the first to say bond. Now, bond has a lot of connotations. People are still very uncomfortable using bond when they must really be using it. They mentioned lone pairs could be hydrogen bond octopsa. And if you look at precise definition of hydrogen bond was elusive when I started my career here. These are from the three books that were all published in the late 90s. All of them say it cannot be defined. In fact, Shainer's book says it's difficult to define. So he wrote three pages of description. Desiraju and Shainer's book was titled as weak hydrogen bond because the CHO hydrogen bond that they wrote it, others would not accept them. And Jeffrey's book was related to biology. But most often, XY distance or HB distance was less than van der Waals radii. And of course, this was linear. And these are things we could verify with a microwave spectroscopy. So we built a microwave spectrometer, which is shown here. We basically use a molecular beam in which two molecules are expanded by supersonic expansion to very low temperature. They can form complexes. And we get the structure by looking at the microwave spectrum. I won't describe the spectrometer or spectroscopy now, but let me tell you the first complex that we studied, that is ethylene H2S. We studied this molecule because ethylene water was studied by Bill Klemperer from Harvard. He had shown that in ethylene water, we have the OH pointing towards the ethylene, and that was called OH by hydrogen bonding. We showed with our microwave spectrum, the structure is exactly like this, SH pointing towards the pi cloud. So we called it SH pi hydrogen bond. The referees were appreciative of the paper. They appreciated the motive, the way it was written, the way it was analyzed, but they said, don't call it a hydrogen bond. So I had to change the title. I put bridging hydrogen bonding and van der Waals interaction, and that's how we published. In fact, just a few years before, during my postdoc, I had looked at benzene H2S, so postdoc was Gutowski. In the introduction, we do mention about hydrogen bonding, but we don't say that in the title, abstract, or conclusions. Within a few years, in 2005, David Sherrill, one of the popular theoreticians today, wrote a paper on this benzene H2S dimer. In the title, he says sulfur pi interactions. No, they don't even say SH pi interaction, because if we say SH pi hydrogen bond, people don't like it. But what's even more interesting is they write clearly. The attraction in H2S benzene is best thought of as arising from a favorable electrostatic interaction put in partially positive hydrogens in H2S and the negative its large pi cloud. If you read any definition of hydrogen bond, you talk about the positive hydrogens and electrons. And still, they were hesitant to call it. They didn't even call it SH pi interaction. They called it sulfur pi interaction. We did write a comment to JPC saying that this is not correct. This is SH pi hydrogen bond. After two reviewers, the editor decided not to publish it. Of course, David Sherrill wrote again another review where he pointed out about our views. If you look at hydrogen sulfide, you know, Pauling was misled because he had the structure at ambient condition, not ambient condition, just when H2S freezes. He realized the hydrogen bond should have hydrogen bonding, hydrogen sulfide should have hydrogen bonding if you go to low temperature and high pressure. And that was in fact done by Loudy and co-workers. And they published this in physical review letter, which most of the chemists don't read. They took H2S and they cooled it further and increased the pressure. And then they say H2S is a good model system where we can tune the hydrogen bond strength from absent or very weak to structurally significant. I was quite convinced. I wrote IUPAC telling them they should change the definition. They wrote me back saying that we agree, why don't you do that? I asked them, how do I do that? They said I should form a task group, not with friends and collaborators, but with some experts from all over the world. We formed this task group. We came up with a definition. As I mentioned, this was published in Pure and Applied Chemistry 2011. IUPAC website is still to include this. Of course, we call it an attractive interaction between a hydrogen atom in which it's bonded to X, which is more electronegative. The main reason is hydrogen should be positive. If you look at diborane, we have negative hydrogen. That is not hydrogen bonding. That's our major conclusion. Even after publishing this IUPAC report, water and H2S in solid remain so. What about the dimers? Water dimer has been studied very well. There have been hundreds of papers on this. H2S dimer, there is very few study. This is what the structure is from theory. We did do some microspectroscopy results. We never published them because we could get only K equal to zero line. If you have only K equal to zero line, K is the angular momentum about the molecular axis. It's basically zero, that means you have two sphere. So it's very difficult to conclude anything. So for my first student, Pankaj Mandal just included this in the thesis. Lovas and Sundaram just presented this in symposium. They never published it. In 2012, Sanjay Vatagongkar published a paper on IR vacuum UV double resonance. He showed there's a 31 wave number redshift, which could be the first experimental evidence. But this bibliography, which listed only four, misses some earlier papers. One is this paper by CNR Rao in India. They did the photoelectron spectroscopy of H2S dimer. They did not even put a structure in this paper. They estimated the binding energy to be about 6 kilojoules per mole, and they concluded it's a van der Waals molecule. Molecular beam electric deflection experiment was done. They did find the microwave spectrum, but they could not get any structure. So this was published in 1979. So if you have only K equal to zero line, we really cannot find what the structure is. So it remained unpublished. Because if you have only K zero, it's like two spheres, exactly like the solid, we cannot get. If we can get K equal to one line, that will imply that there is an angular momentum about this axis. These are not just balls. But the fact that we did find the microwave spectrum implies, even though it could be spherical because of the averaging, the two H2S molecules could be aligned in a dipole-dipole fashion. Because to get the microwave spectrum, we need a dipole moment. So this could have been the structure. But if this were the structure, B and C should have been like this. We should have got an asymmetric top spectrum, K equal to one lines. We did not get. After many years, Chris Metcalf contacted us. He was working with Nick Walker at Newcastle University. They were looking at H2S Mi bond, silver, copper, gold. Whoever is working about the group 11 intermolecular bonds, you look at this papers. A lot of microwave work has been available and all these interactions. But they found some lines from H2S. They thought it could be H2S dimer. They contacted Lovas, who had retired. Lovas contacted us. And Arijit Das, my student, found the K equal to one line, which clearly shows that it has a structure. These are the K0 and K1 lines. I won't describe all the details. Basically, now we can get the B and C. And this B and C are very different than the structure I showed you in which the two dipoles are aligned. From all these rotational constants with several isotopes, we can get the structure accurately. And if you look at the structure, this is water dimer, this H2S dimer, they both look exactly the same. We could do the calculations accurately. They agree very well, both in terms of distances and angles. So we call it a hydrogen bond, and we publish this paper. Arijit also found out that unlike in water case, this is also a minima in H2S. In water case, this would be a saddle point. And of course, H2S is very different because sulfur is more polarizable. We have cis and trans as minima. We didn't think of it as a major difference, but then a group later highlighted this difference and concluded that H2S dimer is not hydrogen bonded. That paper has just been published in PCCP. The main difference for them is they conclude what is the nature here because it is a minima here. In the trans structure, it's still hydrogen bonded. And of course, that's what we feel. Of course, this paper was published in Angewandte Kemie, and American Chemical Society and Royal Society wrote about this. Now, we also suggested hydrogen bonding is just nomenclature. We have halogen bond. Both of them have been defined by IUPAC now. We showed that in methyl fluoride water, we have a very similar interaction, and this is what we called as carbon bond. This was published in PCCP in 2013. Within a few months, Frontero published a paper in Angewandte and Grabowski published a paper in PCCP. They looked at the other elements and they called it a tetral bond. And of course, this has been shown by Pulitzer and others by looking at the electrostatic potential that group 14 elements also have a sigma hole. These interactions are possible. But we had the first look at the carbon, and Frontero and Grabowski looked at the other elements. This was called a tetral bond. What is really interesting about this carbon bond for me is that in methanol, we showed that the CH3 phase is somewhat positive. But if you look at the methane, the CH3 phase is negative. That's where the electron is. So if methane interacts with water, unlike methanol, you could actually have a hydrogen bond. You know, water could interact like this. And of course, we showed this to be a hydrogen bond, but when we tried to send this paper to Kempfis later, it was rejected because referee said this is bound by dispersive forces. You cannot call it a hydrogen bond. What is even more interesting is that this I realized is like the CH5 plus. It's like a birth of CH5 plus. Now, H3O plus is known, ammonium is known, CH5 plus has not been very well characterized. Gas phase spectroscopists like Oka and Nosby did eventually succeed in assigning the spectrum, which is really complex. They concluded that it could be more of a complex between CH3 plus and H2, not like this. This may be more close to CH5 plus than CH5 plus itself, in the sense this is pentacoordinate. I was just thinking about it. If it's actually CH3 plus H2 complex, could it be a hydrogen carbon bond with H2 as the electron donor? That's what we wanted to check. And of course, CH5 plus has attracted a lot of interaction, both from organic chemists and astrophysicists. There are papers in Nature and Science. In Nature in 1995, Dominic Moss concluded that so H2 might be attached to CH3 group. And of course, it's a high resolution spectra, vibrational spectra. You can see this is all CH stretching region, 2000 to 3000 wave number. They drew the structure like this with this. We wanted to see if the structure is really like this. And of course, Takeshi Oka wrote a comment on this article. He says, George Vola wrote to him when he published a paper on H3 plus. He asked him to look at CH5 plus. When the paper came, he says, I did not know Vola or CH5 plus. I was just interested. I was delighted to find that astrophysical interest and organic chemist interest are the same. But he points out that the very concept of molecular structure is problematic for this molecule. That's where Bader comes in handy. He highlights the difference between geometry and structure. In geometry, you know where the atoms are in different places. You know the location, distance, angles. In structure, you need to know how they are bonded. The difficulty is that in structure is that it could be floppy, like in the case of CH5 plus. Bader proposed electron density topology. I'm sure most of the participants are aware of this. In fact, he even said there are no bonds, only bonding. Of course, I would disagree with this. There are bonds except for our own confusion that there isn't. So if you look at the atoms in molecules theory analysis of CH5+, I wanted to find a carbon bond. I thought there'll be a nice H2 interacting with the CH3 plus, forming a carbon bond. It didn't find. And it wasn't even a hydrogen bond. It had 5 CH bonds. We looked at 3 different minima saddle point. All of them had only 5 CH bond, no HH bond. This was somewhat surprising. There's really no carbon bond, but could we have tetral bonds? So we looked at SiH5 plus and GH5 plus. These are the structures defined for the 3 atoms. You can see the CH, SiH, and GH distances. And you can also see the HH distance. In CH5 plus, it's close to 1 angstrom. In SiH5 plus and GH5 plus, it's closer to free H2 distance. So maybe silicon and germanium would show tetral bond. Indeed, they did show tetral bond. Tetral bond is possible even when carbon bond is not. And of course, the key is the electronegative difference. Carbon is more electronegative than hydrogen. So carbon is negative, hydrogen is positive in CH5 plus. So when a proton approaches CH4, it bonds with the carbon, not with the hydrogens. In silicon and germanium, they are both less electronegative. Hydrogen is in fact negative, and silicon and germanium are positive in this. So when a proton leads to SiH4 or GH4, they form a HH bond, which interacts with the central positive atom. So we have a tetral bond, but there is no carbon bond. And of course, this you can easily see if you look at the vibrations. Now, it showed the CH5 plus vibration. The highest frequency vibration is a CH vibration, clearly. I showed the spectra from 2900 to 3000. If you look at silicon and germanium, they are like 4000 wave number. And you look at the mode, you can see here it's more like a symmetric, asymmetric stretching of the CH2. But here you have a free HH vibrations. So clearly in silicon and germanium, we have tetral bond, but in carbon, we don't have a carbon bond. This is clear even if you look at the proton affinity. Methane's proton affinity is 546. Silicon and germanium, the proton affinity is more than 640, 680 kilojoules, 140 kilojoules per mole. If you look at the bond energies of CH and SiH, this would be counterintuitive. CH bond is stronger, SiH bond is weaker, but proton affinity is silane is more. That is because when a proton adds to silane, we form a HH bond, not a SiH bond. When a proton adds to methane, it forms a weaker CH bond. That's why the energy gain is less. We have 2 weak CH bond compared to 1 strong. So we are quite convinced about this. This paper was published again in 2019. We are pleased it could be published in cover the year of periodic table. So contrary to popular description, CH5 plus is not CH3 plus and H2, whereas SiH5 plus and GH5 plus are indeed. When you looked at this, we see this is like a Y or V. This is like a T. These two bonds are both 3 center 2 electron bonds. Here the H2 has 2 electron donates to the positive center. Here these two bonds are formed by total of 2 electrons. So even though both are 3 center 2 electron bonds, this is like V and this is like T. We're wondering, could it have any other shape? We actually found out that we could have delta I, V, T, L, and Y. So this was a paper on classification of a 3 center 2 electron bonds that we just published last year. We showed that all these are possible. Until now, these are classified as either open or closed, but we can have I, delta, Y, L, and T in 3 center 2 electron bonds. Of course, I've come to the last part of my talk. How much time do I have? Okay, maybe another 5-10 minutes. This is a paper we published, hydrogen bonding, halogen bonding, and lithium bonding, both with atoms and molecules and NVO perspective. We talked about a conservation of total bond order inter and intramolecular. This is a plot of binding energy versus electron density. You see this being used by a lot of people, including Bader himself. There is a strong correlation between the electron density at the BCP and the binding energy. What was really interesting is you can see triangles and circles here. That's for hydrogen and chlorine. Crosses here, this is for lithium. Hydrogen and chlorine bonding were similar, but lithium bonding was very different. This had a much steeper slope compared to this. What was even more interesting, this we published at the same time, if I extrapolate the hydrogen-chlorine bonding, it goes to the covalent molecule like ClF, HCl, HBr. If you extrapolate the lithium bonding, it goes to the ionic like Li, Br, LiCl, if you plot the bond critical point in each of them. What's interesting about this lithium fluoride is ionic HF is covalent. Of course, it has a dipole moment. And there is plenty of electron density here. There is very little electron density here, but the bond is stronger here. Because this we know, isn't it? Ionic bonds are pretty strong, but there's not much electrons between the two atoms. Covalent bonds can be strong, but there is plenty of electrons. So we thought this could be an interesting way to look at this. Then we looked at the alkali and alkaline earth metal bonds, lithium, sodium, beryllium, magnesium, calcium. We plotted all of them. You see the slope. All of them are few thousands. You can see all these correlations here. Hydrogen bond was distinctly different from lithium, sodium, beryllium, and magnesium as well. All these ionic molecules have very high slope. Basically, the energy increases steeply as the electron density between the two atoms increase. All of them have very low electron density between them. They are like ionic molecules, but the bond is strong. Hydrogen bond is somewhat like covalent. There is more electron density, but it is still weak. So these are the, you can see the slope again for sodium, magnesium, lithium, beryllium. They are all similar. So we thought we could call them as alkaline bond. We don't need two names for the alkali metals and alkaline earth metals. They both behave the same way. Of course, 2000 to 5000 is very different, but that is, you can see the difference between sodium and magnesium, and beryllium, sodium and lithium, they are high. But hydrogen and chlorine are less than 1000. We wanted to extend this further. In fact, alkaline bond was the title of my talk in the first NCL ICNI. We looked at all the periods with 9 different acceptors, hydrogen first group, second group, third group, up to 17th group. We were surprised to find all of them having somewhat similar. Some of them are less than 1000, some of them are a few thousands. We draw a periodic table now with these slopes. Now, if we look at them, you can see all these intermolecular bonds are somewhat similar. Some are similar, some are different, but they don't go with the period or group. They depend on the element. Carbon is distinctly different from the rest. Boron is different from the rest in the group. Hydrogen, of course, is very different. You can see fluorine is certainly different. Nitrogen-phosphorus difference is less. So if you plot it this way, we can create a periodic table for intermolecular interactions or bonding, I would say bonding. So in this, if it is blue, we have mostly ionic molecules. If it is green, we have mostly covalent molecules. But carbon is an exception. It's a covalent molecule, but the slope is close to 2000. It's almost escaped blue. Why is carbon very different? We realize carbon is different because methane is like Cl minus or K plus. It has a saturated density. It's almost spherical. There is no excess electron or there is no low-lying orbital to accept or donate electrons. So methane behaves like ionic molecule. So that is very different. So you see in this periodic table, we can understand the interactions better. A much higher slope in carbon is because it's completely full. Boron has considerably lower slope compared to the other elements. So we can clearly see the difference. So we can, in a sense, have only two kinds of intermolecular bonding. One in which covalent molecules are involved in intermolecular bonding, hydrogen, halogen, chalcogen, nitrogen, tetral, excluding carbon, boron, but not real. There is a significant electron density between the atoms in this group, and binding energy only gradually increases. On the other hand, you can have intermolecular bonding of ionic molecules, IMBI and IMBC. This is all we really need. Lithium, sodium, beryllium, magnesium, all of them are alkaline bond. That's what we say. And perhaps carbon bonding too, even though it is covalent, because it has a full electron count. So these have very low electron density between the atoms, and binding energy rises very steeply in this. What's really interesting, if you look at this, is from the paper I mentioned initially. You look at N2, NaF, neon 2. Neon 2 is typical van der Waals. The electron density drops very dramatically, reaches almost zero. In N2, there is plenty of electrons between the atoms. Sodium fluoride is ionic. It also has very low electron density. See, Van der Waals interaction is the weakest ionic is the strongest, but both have very low electron density. Covalent molecules are different. If you look at carbon bond, this is almost like this. Sodium bond is like ionic molecule, but BF3OH2, of course, these numbers are here small, but you see there's more electron density. So hydrogen bond, halogen bond, boron bond are all similar. Carbon bond, sodium bond, and ionic bonds and van der Waals interaction are different. And this is all we really need. I come to the end of my talk. Microspectroscopic investigation and weakly bound complexes have helped us in understanding hydrogen bonding from a fundamental point of view, and also discover carbon bond. It has also helped in giving us a unified view of intermolecular interactions, and atoms and molecules theory has really helped it in looking at the bond. I will stop here. I would thank you all. I'll be happy to answer any questions you have. Thank you all.